Good morning students, how are you? I hope you all are doing fine. Students, today I am going to teach history chapter 2. The name of the chapter is From Trade to Political Supremacy, Colonial Rule in India. In this chapter, you are going to learn about mercantilism, origin of East India Company, European rivals. Here European rivals, four important European countries like English, Portuguese, Dutch and French. Battle of Plassey and Buxar, Anglo-Mysore War, Anglo-Maratha War, Subsidiary Alliance, Doctrine of Labs, Administrative Structure of India under the British rule. Let us see one by one. Students, you know very well the Mughal Empire founded by Babur in 1526. So, who was the founder of the Mughal Empire? Babur in 1526. So, began to decline following the death of Aurangzeb, the last of the great Mughals in 1707. So, already we have discussed in the first chapter. After the death of Aurangzeb, the entire Mughal Empire was declined. So by 1750, the Mughal Empire had been reduced to just a faint shadow of illustrious past. So it had already disintegrated, yielding place to a number of regionals. After the death of Aurangzeb, lot of number of regional kingdoms was formed. This situation proved to be a blessing in disguise for the English East India Company, because there were no good ruler. So at that time only English East India Company entered India. So this is the chance for them, so which was keen to play a dominant role in the political and economic affairs of the Indian subcontinent. Because in India we don't have a strong and power ruler. So these opportunities English East India Company they have to utilize, and they play the dominant role in the political and economic affairs of the Indian subcontinent. Is it clear this first paragraph? Okay. Mercantilism. Here first you have to understand what is mercantilism. Mercantilism means commercialism or getting profit by trading with other countries. Mercantilism was a economic theory which was common in Europe from 16th to 18th century. Mercantilism was a profit making economic policy. It was the theory of trade through which mercantile trading companies makes profit. How they are making the profits? Companies, trading companies makes profit by buying goods cheap and selling them at higher prices. So according to this theory, the prosperity of a country depended on its capability to produce more than it consumed and export more than it imported in order to maintain a positive balance of trade. So I will explain. Mercantilism was a profit making economic policy. So during the 16th to 18th century, all the progressive European countries wanted to make profits through trade. All progressive European countries wanted to make profits through trade. So how they will get profit? It was understood that a country would progress if it produced more than its consumption. So they have to produce more than its consumption. Hence the country started exporting more imported raw materials at cheaper rates for profits. So it was the theory of trade through mercantile trading companies makes profit by buying goods cheap and selling them at higher prices. The race to profits led to monopoly in trade, and trade was among the European countries. Thus, the profit making policy, or thus the mercantilism or profit making policy, led to monopoly in trade, and trade was among the progressive European countries. So, mercantilism is an economic policy whereby a nation aims to maximize export and minimize the imports, maximizing the use of their own resources. Then only they will get profit. One of the main features of the practice of mercantilism was overseas trade. So, overseas trade carried out by the sea routes was the most important feature of the practice of mercantilism. The origin of the English East India Company. You know very well, English East India Company, and its power lay in the economic theory and practice of mercantilism. So, the English East India Company also practiced the policy of mercantilism. Is it clear, students? Origin of the EEIC. Here, EEIC means English East India Company. The English East India Company was established in London in the year 1600 by a royal charter issued by Queen Elizabeth I, the Queen of England. According to this charter, the company got the sole rights of trade in the East Indies, which included all places east of Cape of Good Hope. Let us explain, students. You know, the European countries began to form trading companies to trade with the East. One of them was the English East India Company. English East India Company was started by a group of English merchants. In 1600, Queen Elizabeth I gave it a charter which granted the company the exclusive right to trade with the East. According to that charter, which granted that company the exclusive right to trade with the East. This means that no other trading group from England could compete with the company. So here, can I ask one question? Who was the ruler of England in 1600? Who was the ruler of England in 1600? Queen Elizabeth I was the ruler of England in 1600. Why did the traders prefer the sea routes to the land routes? So see the in your book IQ questions. Page number 139, IQ question, why did the traders prefer the sea routes to the land routes? To compare land routes, traders always prefer the sea routes. What is the reason? Traders prefer sea routes as compared to land routes because large volumes can be shipped at low cost through sea routes. Using the sea routes is much easier and faster than going through the traditional land routes. The lack of safety and crossing great distance. The lack of safety and crossing great distance are considered as a plus factor in sea trading than overland trade routes. Overland trade routes. Is it clear, students? Traders prefer sea routes as compared to land routes because large volumes can be shipped at low cost through sea routes. Using the sea routes is much easier and faster than going through the traditional land routes. The lack of safety and crossing great distance are considered as a plus factor in sea trading than overland trade routes. Is it clear, students? Let us see the journey of English East India Company in India. Look at this picture. Who is he? He was William Hawkins. He was the first captain. William Hawkins led the first voyage of the English East India Company to India in 1608. He reached India in 1608. His crew sailed to the port of Surat. He got some trade concessions from that then Mughal ruler Jahan. At that time Mughal ruler was Jahangir, so he got some trade concessions from Jahangir. So as a result, a trading post or factory was established in Surat by the English in 1613. The first English factory in South India was established in Masulipatnam in 1611. Look at this picture. Who is he? Sir Thomas Rowe. In 1615, Sir Thomas arrived in India as the ambassador of King James I of England. He received a royal firman from the Mughal Emperor Jahangir. Here, what is the meaning of firman? Order. So, he received a royal order from the Mughal Emperor Jahangir. This royal order allowed the English East India Company to set up factories in Agra, Ahmedabad and some other places. Let us see the presidency towns. Presidency towns were the administrative divisions of British governance in India. Between 1612 to 1757, the English East India Company set up factories, trading posts in several locations, mostly in coastal India, with the consent of Mughal emperors or local rulers. The company gradually acquired sovereignty over large part of India, now called presidency. The company gradually acquired sovereignty over large parts of India, now called presidency. That is, three important presidency were there. One is presidency towns of Madras, Bombay and Calcutta. First one, Madras presidency. The British established their factory in Masulipatnam in 1611. In 1639, they received a piece of land in the village of Madras Patnam on lease from local Raja. They set up the agency Port St. George in Madras in 1614. The agency was upgraded at presidency in 1652. Next, Bombay presidency. The island of Bombay, which was under the rule of Gujarat King Sultan, it was transferred to the control of Portuguese in 1534. In 1668, Bombay was given away to the British King Charles II by his father-in-law and the King of Portugal. Shortly afterwards, the East India Company got it from Charles II on lease and fortified it for protection against the Marathas. Bombay became the important base of East India Company in India. In 1698, the company got the zamindari rights of three villages. Here, zamindari rights means right to collect taxes. Three villages, namely Sudhanuti, Govindapur and Kolikata. They built Fort William around it factory. This was how the city of Calcutta came into existence. The company persuaded Mughal emperor to issue a firman. Firman, as you know, firman means royal order, royal edicts. The company tried continuously to press more concessions and manipulating existing privileges. The firman were continuously misused by the company officials. The company officials used the privilege of firman for carrying out their private trade. Here, private trade, buying or selling things of their personal use. They also refused to pay the taxes. These company officials also refused to pay the taxes. This resulted in enormous loss of revenue in Bengal. The local rulers were also not happy by the expanding fortification of the company. In 1717, the Mughal ruler Firuz Shah issued a firman giving the British East India Company the right to reside and trade in the Mughal Empire. They were allowed to trade freely in Bengal, Bihar and Odisha except for a yearly payment of 3,000 rupees. They also got the additional rights to trade in the Deccan and Gujarat. The East India Company and other European companies made huge profits by the trade concession they got from the Indian rulers. They bought goods, especially cotton, cloth, silk, spices, salt, etc. in India and exported them to Europe. Is it clear, students? Students, look at this Indian map. This map shows the European settlements in India during 1498 to 1739. During this period, four important European countries such as Portuguese, English, French and Dutch. These four country settlements in India, you can see here. So now we are going to see the English settlements. As English settlements marked as symbol like cross. So wherever cross is there, that place English settlements in India. So Hooghly, let us see Hooghly, then Calcutta, then Visakhapatnam, then Madras, then here Bombay, Surat, all these wherever cross symbol is there, that is English settlements in India during this period. Is it clear, students? That's all for today class. I hope you all understood. We will meet you next class. Till then, revise the chapter thought. Thank you. Have a nice day.